All right, well, break out your Bibles. Something I forgot to mention, if you got a bulletin, prayer slips in there. If you need prayer requests, please fill that out. Nobody's going to come beat on your door unless you want us to come beat on your door. But we do, does give us an opportunity to pray for people if they'll fill that slip out and drop it in the offering plate. If you didn't do that, you can just drop it in the basket when you leave, or you can just hand it to me today as you're headed out the back door. When I started planning what we're going to talk about today, I honestly thought it was going to be a two-part thing. It would take us 2 weeks to do it. And that might be the case, but I don't think so. I think we're going to get through it today. So I'm just going to kind of see where the Spirit leads us. If y'all, most of y'all have been here for a while and you kind of know how I roll. I've really struggled with this message because some of it is, I don't know, I don't want to use the word boring, but a lot of times we find the Old Testament boring. A lot of times we think, well, that doesn't apply to me. But if you're a mature Christian, you know that the Bible says that all of Scripture is good for teaching, for edifying, for encouraging. It doesn't say just the New Testament. It doesn't say just the parts we like. It doesn't say just the parts that we want to pull out and use in that context to make us right in an argument. It says all of it. And so I'm going to be mentioning a lot of Scripture today. There's no way we can physically flip to all of it and read it all, so just be ready to make notes and that kind of stuff. But I wanted to talk to you about rebuilding the temple. Now, if you were here Wednesday night, then you heard a lot of stuff about where we are prophetically and where we are as far as the last Wednesday night before the snow, some stuff that could be happening soon in Israel. In the news recently, we have talked a lot about that the settlements in Israel are a big sticking point politically. Pay attention to that. When you're listening to the news or watching the news, pay close attention when they talk about what's happening in Israel with the settlements. That is a very big prophetic thing. Anytime you hear the mention of the Temple Mount, the Dome of the Rock, or the Israeli Temple, pay attention to that. That's a big prophetic thing. But that's in the news almost every day. It's at least in the news indirectly every day, and some days directly in the news. But pay attention to those things. We're not really talking prophetically today about rebuilding of the temple, but we are going to talk about how rebuilding the temple applies to your life and applies to my life and how we can apply those lessons every day in our walk. Okay? So let's go to the Old Testament. Let's go to 1 Kings. And you know 1 Kings is easy to find because it's right before 2 Kings, all right? See? You know your Bible front and back. That's awesome. So we're in 1 Kings chapter 6. And I just want to give you a little history here of the temple in Israel. So Moses was told by God to build an ark. And y'all know the story of the Ark of the Covenant. And he did. And then later, many generations later, David had the Ark of the Covenant. And he said, God, I am in this nice place and you're not. Your ark just is in a tent. That's what Moses and the Israelites would do. They just leave it in a tent. And so David said, I want to build you this huge house and this beautiful temple to store your Ark of the Covenant, because that's where you dwell. And God said, you can't do it because you've got blood on your hands, but your son will. And so one of David's sons, Solomon, built God a temple. And that's where we're picking up in 1 Kings chapter 6. So 1 Kings chapter 6 verse 1 says, in the 480th year after the Israelites had come out of Egypt, that's the Exodus, the book of Exodus, that's what it's talking about. In the fourth year of Solomon's reign over Israel, in the month of Ziv, and I've told you before, God doesn't have January, February, March, April, okay? That's what we've made up from the Romans and the Greeks. Later in history, later after what we're reading about here, when Israel is overran by the Babylonians, they kind of adopt Babylonian names for their months, but they have never gone by January, February, March, April, okay? So second month is not February to them, all right? Second month for them falls in our March, April, maybe even May, depending on how the calendar falls that year. In the second month, he began to build the temple of the Lord, okay? So Solomon builds the temple, and he houses the Ark of the Covenant in it, and we're staying in Kings. And just flip over a page or two to chapter 8, and we're picking up in chapter 8, verse 6. and I'm going to skip around here, but this is basically chapter 8, 6 through 13. The priest then brought the Ark of the Lord's Covenant to the place in the inner sanctuary in the temple, the most holy place, and put it beneath the wings of the cherubim. Okay, so this was the whole objective of the temple. We want to build a place so that the Ark of the Covenant can be inside of it, because God dwelled right there wherever the Ark of the Covenant was. You know, if you know the stories of the Ark of the Covenant, if somebody touched it, they would die, because it was God's presence on that covenant, on the Ark of the Covenant, also called the Ark of the Testimony. So jump down to verse 9. There was nothing in the ark except the two stones that Moses had placed in there that he'd been given at Horeb when the Lord made a covenant with the Israelites and they came out of Egypt. Those are the Ten Commandments. Those are the two stones of the Ten Commandments that Moses put in there. Now, if you are familiar with Hebrews, you know, a lot of people say, well, the Bible's got contradictory stuff in it. This says one thing, this says another. There's contradictions in the Bible. It's just a bunch of books written by men. Yeah, it's a good story, but it's not all factual. Well, I'm here to tell you that is a lie from the devil. This book is 100% accurate. It is the living, breathing Word of God. It was good back then. It was good yesterday. It's good today. It'll be good tomorrow. God's Word does not change. And we could spend hours spelling out how there's proof after proof after proof that the ancient manuscripts that were originally written, that we're reading here today, have never changed. Now, some people have tried to change them. Some people have left stuff out, put stuff in. There are corrupt copies out there. But we have a chain of evidence that proves that this is the word breathed by God Himself, and that it is not wrong, and there are not contradictions. And if you read something in the Bible and you're like, well, that's a contradiction, that part's right, this part's wrong, you are not understanding the context of it. It is you or me that is wrong. It is not the Word of God that is wrong. A great example is in Hebrews. Hebrews says that the Ark of the Covenant contained the stone tablets, which we just read. It also says in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 4, that it contained Aaron's rod that had budded, and it contained a jar of the manna that had fallen from heaven, if you remember those stories of the Exodus. Well, there's no mention of those things here, but there is in Hebrew. So which story is correct? If you read this and say, well, the only thing that was in there was the Ten Commandments, and if you read Hebrews, it says the Ten Commandments were in there, Aaron's rod, his staff was in there, and there was a jar of manna in there. Well, you can't have it both ways, right? And some people say, well, maybe at some point the jar and the rod were taken out of there. The only problem with that was every time you hear about somebody touching the ark that wasn't supposed to, they drop dead. So that probably didn't happen. But if you understand the exact Greek from the original manuscript that Hebrews was written in, every time you're reading the New Testament, you're either reading stuff that was written in Aramaic or Greek. And when you read that, the word that says that the rod and the jar were in the ark, that exact Hebrew word means among the ark. And so if you don't know what you're reading, if you don't know your context of your Bible, then you can get in a little trap. And somebody can say, well, it says in Hebrews that everything, all these other things were in the ark. And it says in Kings that this is the only thing that was in the ark. The Bible has discrepancies. But if you know the story of the way the ark was used, they placed utensils around the ark. There were things that were in the room of the ark, among the ark, but not right down inside of the ark itself. And that's all Hebrews is saying, is those things were among the ark. In fact, there's stories where they would place Aaron's rod, lean it against the ark itself as they would travel, and it was a symbolism of God going before them. And so there's scriptural evidence and there's historical evidence that the jar of manna and the rod of Aaron were placed in the same room as the Ark of the Covenant, among the Ark of the Covenant. Not literally open up the lid and put it down in there, okay? So this is just a kind of a side note, a warning that you're reading something here that doesn't exactly match what you find in Hebrews. And the reason why is because when we translate from Greek or Aramaic to English, we don't always have the exact perfect word to do it. We have to get the word that's closest that we can find. Same thing for Hebrew in the Old Testament. But if you know the story of the Ark of the Covenant and how it was used, you know that there were utensils and things placed around the ark, among the ark, but not down in it. So be careful when somebody tries to take the Bible and say to you, this is right, this is wrong. because it's all right. Be careful when somebody says to you, well, that's not really what the Bible says. We've lost that in translation. If it says it, it means it, okay? You have to understand why it says it and what the context is. And a lot of times you need five other scriptures to explain the one scripture you've just read. But scripture does interpret itself, is what the Bible says. But you got to know it all to put all the pieces together. See, it would have been really easy for God to sit down and say, I'm going to write you everything you need to know in chronological order and the way you'll need to know it the rest of your life. That would have been easy. And He's God. He can do that. But where is the faith in that? Where is the growth if you don't have to sit down and search out the things of God? If you just walked out your front door and it was all there on the front porch and Amazon had delivered it that day, there'd be no faith growing. There'd be no opportunity to grow in your faith. There'd be no opportunity to grow spiritually. It's just all right there. Just pick it up, put it in your pocket, and you got it. He wants us to search. Well, why does it say that there? He wants us to find out if it says something about it in the Old Testament. Is it repeated again in the New Testament? You know, almost a third of the New Testament quotes the Old Testament. But yet we'll say, well, that part doesn't apply to me. That's Old Testament. Jesus said, I didn't come to destroy the Old Testament, the old laws. I came to fulfill them. Okay? So when we're talking about this temple being rebuilt, we're not talking about some ancient story that doesn't apply to us today. They are fighting wars right now that are all about this temple being rebuilt in Israel. So it does pertain to us. There are things happening at the UN right now. There are things happening in Washington, D.C. right now. There are things happening in the Obama administration and the Trump transition team right now that will affect the rebuilding of the temple in Israel. And people have died. Thousands of people have died over it. Maybe millions. And thousands more will die over this. So it pertained to them, but it does pertain to us today and tomorrow. This is not an ancient story. This is scripture that's important and will and does apply to our lives. So as we read this, don't get lost in the, oh, I can't stand the Old Testament, the kings and the queens and this and that and the numbers. This is talking about you and me. All right, so let's keep going. So he says, there was nothing in it except what was placed in the stone, the stones from Egypt. Verse 10 says, when the priest withdrew from the holy place, the cloud filled the temple of the Lord, and the priests could not perform their services because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the temple. So it tells us that when the ark was placed in this temple, that God's presence came in, filled the temple, and it was so bright and so overwhelming that the priests could not go in there and perform their duties. They had to walk out. All right? So it's kind of mission accomplished for Solomon. He puts the Ark of the Covenant inside the temple, and God shows up. Okay? He gets it right. How many times in our lives have we gotten it right? Where we do exactly what God is telling us to do. You know, who told Solomon how to build the temple? Solomon didn't just wake up one day and say, you know what I think I'm going to do? I'm going to build it in a square. And it's going to have these pretty things here and some pretty things here. God told him specifically, here's how you build it. Here are the measurements of every room. Here's what you do in every room. This is what every room is for. And God spelled out to him exactly how to build it. And Solomon followed it to the letter. And when he was done, God filled the temple. If we do what God is calling us to do, He'll show up. Now, He's there the whole time. But He will make His presence known. If I do what God is calling us to do, He'll show up. How many times in your prayer life have you said, God, where are you? Well, He's there, but sometimes you can't see or feel His presence. It happens. That's reality. For whatever reason, sometimes you cannot feel the presence of God in your life. Maybe it's because you've moved too far away, or maybe He's being quiet because He wants you to seek Him out. But there are times in your life and my life when we can go back and look at our lives and we can say, where are you, God? I don't see you. I don't feel you. I don't hear you. Just tell me. I want to do what you want me to do, but I don't know. Where are you? And I know I'm not the only one that's ever felt that way. And I'm promising you, if you will stick to what this says and you will humble yourselves and follow His will and not our own, when we get to the end of that mission, He'll show up. Now, in hindsight, we'll see all along He was there. But that moment when He fills that temple, put yourself in their shoes that day. They've never had a temple. The Ark of the Covenant had been toted around in tents. It had been stolen. David got it back. And here they've got it, and they're building this temple. It takes them years to build this thing, and they finally build it, and they roll the Ark of the Covenant in there, and this is this beautiful golden, it's gold everywhere, okay? Elaborate temple. And they're like, we did it. All right. Now let's go in there and let's perform the first sacrifice and ritual. And before they can get in the front door, God fills the place up. Now what if you were standing out there in those outer courts and you saw that take place? What a testimony that would be for the rest of your life. You had seen the literal presence of God fill a room. Could you live your life the same way after that? Those people that stood there and saw that happen, could they walk out and somebody say, hey, I heard you were there the day that the Holy Spirit filled the temple and it was so bright the priest had to leave, had to go like this and leave. Oh yeah, I was there, no big deal. Bah. That's not what they'd say, of course not. They'd be like, yeah, I was there, let me tell you about it. Man, it was awesome. And they would have stories to tell. And don't you think that it changed the way they lived their lives? That's another thing. When the Holy Spirit enters into the temple, when He shows up, if you're there, it's going to change your life. You won't go on the status quo. It won't be as like it's always been. There will be some changes. Okay? All right, let's keep looking here. Verse 12, Solomon said, the Lord has said that He would dwell in a dark cloud. I have indeed built a magnificent temple for you, a place for you to dwell forever. A couple of things right here. Number one, God says, I'm going to be in there forever. Solomon says, I want to build it for you forever. And so you got Solomon saying, this is where I want you to dwell forever. That's the purpose of this temple. And God saying, okay, I'll do that. I will be there forever. He says later, if you look in verse 9, chapter 9, verse 3, chapter 8 is really big, a long chapter. But flip to chapter 9, verse 3. This is God talking in chapter 9, verse 3. He says, the Lord said to him, I have heard the prayer and plea you have made before me. I have consecrated this temple which you have built by putting my name there forever. My eyes and my heart will always be there. I've never been to the Temple Mount in Israel, but many people have been. And they will all tell you the same thing. It's an experience that will change you because God's presence is there. Not that He's not in this room, not that He's not in your heart, but God has said, forever I will be present right there. Forever my eyes will be right there. So when you go to the Temple Mount, you are standing in a place that was created by God Himself to be a place where He would dwell forever. See, God doesn't do things on a temporary basis. He doesn't show up in your life and then disappear and show back up a little while later. He walked and talked in the garden with Adam and Eve because He wanted to be with them. He had a presence at the Ark of the Covenant because He wanted to be with Moses and the Israelites. He showed up in the temple with Solomon and all the kings because He wanted to be there with them. He came to earth as Jesus Christ, as a man, to dwell among us because He wanted to be with us. He's coming back to get us because He wants to be with us. He's coming back at the second coming to rule on earth forever and ever because He wants to dwell among men. He has always, to this day and tomorrow, wants to dwell with you and with me. He wants to show up in our lives, but sometimes we don't let that happen. Okay, let's keep digging. Let's go. Ezra comes in, tears it down, destroys it. It leads into 70 years of captivity. And if you're here Wednesday night, we talked a lot about King Cyrus giving the decree to rebuild the temple. About 100 years before King Cyrus was born, in the book of Isaiah, God says, I'm going to call Cyrus. He's not a righteous man. He doesn't acknowledge me as Lord and Savior. But I'm going to call him and I'm going to use him and he's going to rebuild. He's going to send a decree to rebuild the temple. And about 100 years later, that's what happens. King Cyrus is born and he signs a decree saying, okay, this, you guys from Israel can go back to Israel. You can go back and rebuild your settlements, which is a big thing that's going to be in the news or is in the news now. And he says, you can go back and lay the foundations of your temple and rebuild the temple. Now again, put yourselves in these people's shoes. Let's say that you're a young teenager, okay? You're 13, 14 years old, and you're in Israel, and you have seen Solomon complete the temple. And it's this incredible, magnificent day. And Then you start to see kings come in after Solomon who are corrupt and defile the temple. And then you live long enough to see that things aren't happening at the temple the way they should. And you tell, you know, you're an older person, you know, you're great granddad or great great grandma, and you're telling your grandkids, I remember when King Solomon was alive and we would go to the temple and God's glory filled the temple, but we've sinned so much and we've rebelled so much that it's not like it used to be. Does that sound familiar? How many of you heard your grandmother or your granddad say, boy, it's not like it used to be? How many of us have told our kids, it's not like it used to be? Why is it not like it used to be? Is it because we're getting better? Is it because we're progressing? Is it because we're smarter and have better technology? It's not like it used to be because of sin, isn't it? The more the sin controls the society, the more we're going to say it's not like it used to be. And that's the slippery slope they were on. Okay, now you're a 15-year-old, and you have seen the temple be destroyed. It's hundreds of years later after King Solomon has built his temple. You're a 15-year-old teenager, and you see Nebuchadnezzar come in and destroy this temple. And you've heard the stories of how great it used to be. And you see the beauty of the temple and all the gold and all the elaborate silver and all these things, the brass and the bronze, and it's destroyed and wiped out. And you get taken as a slave into Babylon, where Iran is today, or Iraq. And you're in Iran or Iraq as a slave, and you're underneath this rulership of these different kings that don't know your one true God, that don't give a flip about your temple. And then, 70 years later, you're 85 years old. And this new king signs a law and says, you can go back to Israel. And not only can you go back, but you can rebuild Israel. You can rebuild its towns, its little cities, its communities. And you can rebuild that temple. Whoa, I remember the temple when I was 15 years old. It was amazing. And we're going to go back and we're going to get to rebuild that. And so this generation goes back 70 years later and they start to rebuild the temple. Let's go to Ezra. If you're in Kings, just keep going towards the New Testament. Ezra chapter 1, verse 1. After Kings and Chronicles, you hit Ezra. Ezra chapter 1, verse 1 says, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, and this is something that God predicted in the Bible, in Isaiah, 100 years before it happened. Cyrus had not even been born yet. In order to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah, the Lord moved the heart of Cyrus, the king of Persia. I said Isaiah, I meant Jeremiah. And to make a proclamation throughout his realm and to put it into writing. This is what Cyrus the king of Persia said. The Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth and has appointed me to build a temple for him at Jerusalem in Judah. So now here you are. You were 15 years old and you saw the temple destroyed. And here you are at 85 years old and people say, guess what? We're going back. We're going back to our homeland of Israel. We're going back to Jerusalem. And not only are we going back, but they're going to let us rebuild this temple. You can imagine the joy and the excitement that were in the people. Do you know some people didn't want to go back? If you read the stories in Ezra and Nehemiah, there were a lot of people that didn't want to go back. Then you sit here and you read this story and you're like, why would they not want to go back? They're in captivity in Babylon and they can go back and rebuild God's temple where he dwells and shows up. Well, they didn't want to go back for the same reasons me and you wouldn't want to go back. It's hard work. Go back and build it. Who's going to build it? Me and you are. It wasn't go back and I'll have my people build it for you. It was go back and you can rebuild it. Well, I don't know, man. I'm pretty comfortable right here. I'm 85 years old. I don't know about this traveling back to Jerusalem and getting out hammering and nails and building walls. That don't sound like fun. And you can imagine Ezra and Nehemiah going, but we're rebuilding God's city for God, for him to have a place among us, and we're going to dwell with God. I know, man, but oof. You know, some people don't want us to do that. What if we have to fight? What if we get invaded? What if we had to go to war again? That's just not worth the trouble. And there's a lot of obstacles that will make us say, I know what God's calling me to do, but man, that's a lot of trouble. And the biggest enemy that we have is to be comfortable and complacent. And that's where the Israelis were. They were comfortable. They were complacent. Always have been, always will be. That's human nature. We don't like change, and we definitely don't want to have to go do some things that aren't fun to do, no matter what the great mission is behind it. Think of the Exodus when they left Egypt. These people were slaves. They were being beaten by taskmasters, having to make brick every day. And they leave, and they've got their freedom, and they're going to the promised land. And they got thirsty, and they got mad, and they rebelled against Moses because they were thirsty. Or they got hungry, so they rebelled and complained. Or they were getting seeds, manna from heaven, and they were like, well, we're sick of this. We want some meat. So they complain that they don't have water, then they get water. Then they complain they don't have food, and they get food. Then they complain about the type of food they have. And they want to go back. And they said, why didn't we go back? At least we would die with a full belly in Egypt. At least we'd have tombs to be buried in instead of dying out here by the Red Sea, drowning in the Red Sea, right before God parted it for them. But that's human nature. Humans haven't changed. These stories of cavemen running around, beating their wives over the head with a club and dragging them into their cave, that's a myth. Now, maybe there have been men that beat the women over the head with a club and drug them into a cave, but we were never running around as idiot Neanderthals. Human nature has never changed. We are prone to do what we want to do. Our flesh says do what you want to do when you want to do it because it feels good. That was the same for Adam and Eve after they fell, and it is the same for us. That doesn't change. All right? So they're going back, they're rebuilding the temple. And if you look in, we're in Ezra, if you look at chapter 3. Ezra chapter 3, I think it's verse 12, says, all the people gave a great shout to praise the Lord because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid, talking about the temple. Verse 12 says, but many of the older priests and Levites and family heads who had seen the former temple wept when they saw the foundation of the temple being laid. Think about that. You're that 15-year-old that had seen the former beautiful temple. Here you are 70 years later, you're 85 years old, and they rebuild this thing out of wood and sticks and iron, and they wept because they remembered what the other one looked like and how it used to be and what it is today. And you know, the biggest difference there is, if you go back to Solomon's temple, although it was human hands that built it, it was God's design that built it. Basically, God built the first temple. He told them how to do it, when to do it, everything they needed to do it. He told them what to use. The second temple, they just got whatever cedar trees they could, whatever supplies they could get together, and they built it themselves. They tried to go by the dimensions of the old temple, but the difference between the two was God built the first one. It was God's design on the first one. The second one was man-made. And we do that, don't we? God says, I've got this great thing built for you. And we say, I think I'm going to build my own. No, I got this great plan and design for you. Yeah, I know, but I'm pretty comfortable right here. And what ends up happening, instead of this beautiful mansion of a temple, our lives are this stick shack. And God looks at our lives and he says, you know, you're living in this one-room stick shack of a spiritual life, and I've got this huge, beautiful temple built for you and designed for you. Why don't you just walk out of that crab shell you're in, like a hermit crab, and crawl into this bigger, nicer one? You know, that's what hermit crabs do. They outgrow their shell, and they crawl out, and they find a bigger shell. And God's saying, you're in this little bitty, cramped up, tiny, rotten space of a spiritual life, and I've got this huge, beautiful temple for you to walk in. Why don't you walk over here? You know, it's the one true example of the grass being greener on the other side. You know, we always think the grass is always greener, and it's not. But then, in God's terms, where we are now, he's got greener grass for us. If we'll just walk across the front yard and say, here I am. What do you want me to do? All right? Let's look at that next slide. So what about Jesus? Jesus pops on the scene. Did Jesus have interactions with the temple? Well, if you're familiar with Jesus' life, when Jesus was 40 days old, they took him to the temple because that was the Jewish tradition. A male, if you had a baby boy, on his 40th day, you would take him to the temple. And you would have you would give him a name. You would do there was specifics, religious things that would happen on that 40th day, including the name. And so they took him at the 40th day. And then you know the story, when Jesus was 12 years old, they couldn't find him. Everybody had gone to Jerusalem for the celebration, and they had left. You know, there's a caravan of people, and they couldn't find Jesus. You know, they're looking through their crowd, their family reunion that's going with them, and they're like, hey, has anybody seen Jesus? Hadn't seen him all day. Has anybody seen Jesus? And they go back, and they search for him. It takes days, but they find him, and they find him in the temple. And he's teaching in the temple at 12 years old. And they're like, where have you been? Your mom and I have been looking for you everywhere. And Jesus says the famous line, don't you know I would be about my Father's business in my Father's house? Where else would I be? Now think about that. Jesus at 12 says, where else would I be? If you're looking for me, it should be easy to find me. I'm Jesus. I'm going to be in my Father's house. Where can people find us? If somebody's looking for you on a Sunday morning, it's an emergency. They can't get you on their phone. They got to find you. They got to talk to you face to face at 11 o'clock on Sunday morning. Where are you going to be? I mean, obviously you're here right here right now, right? Is that normally the case? We find a lot of excuses not to go to God's house on Sunday, don't we? You know, it's one thing if it snows a foot and you can't get out of your driveway and church is closed. That's pretty understandable. But if I was up late Saturday, or I might, yep, there's one sniffle. Yeah, I can't go today. Got one sniffle. Can't do it. Now, I don't make everybody else sick, but Ryan's got to sing. If I showed up and make him sick, he won't even be able to sing. Poor guy. Yeah, that's a sniffle. I'm going to sleep in. We find a lot of reasons not to go to God's house. Now, it's easy on Sunday to say, well, yeah, you'll find me at church on Sunday. But what if I had to find you on a Friday night? You know, if they were looking for Jesus on a Friday night, it'd probably be pretty easy to find Jesus. But if somebody's looking for me on a Friday night, where are they going to find me? If they're looking for you on a Saturday night, where are they going to find you? What if they found you? Would you be embarrassed? Or would you be like, hey, come on in? Now, most of us could probably say, yeah, I'm not doing anything I shouldn't be. I'm not going to be at the strip bar on Saturday night. If you want to come find me, come find me. I ain't got nothing to be ashamed of. That's one thing. That's where your physical presence is. But what about your spiritual presence? Where are you spiritually? If God says, I'm going to go and paint a picture of what the house that your spirit life is in, what it looks like, would he paint a picture of Solomon's temple? Or would there be no temple at all? Would it be like these dark woods with no light? And you need to walk out of the dark woods. All right? So Jesus was in the temple. Luke, you don't have to go here, but Luke 21:37 says, and this is near the end of Jesus's his ministry, it says that each day Jesus was in the temple teaching. Each day. See, Jesus has always wanted to be in the temple teaching us. Let's look at the next slide. When Jesus was crucified at the resurrection, there was a great earthquake. The temple veil was torn in two. Ryan mentioned that in one of the songs today. And again, I didn't know he was going to mention that. But it was here it is on one of our slides. So God must be trying to tell us something. The veil that was in the temple was torn in two. You know, an interesting thing about how this veil was torn? If me or you walked up to a giant curtain, and it's from the ceiling down to the floor, and somebody says, Duncan, I want you to tear that curtain in two, and here's a knife or a big set of sheer scissors to do it. Here's what I would have to do. Maybe you're smarter than me, but my mind would be, okay, pick it up, cut it, go up as far as I can, get a ladder, cut the rest, right? Well, I would start from the bottom and cut up, because that's the part I get to first. That's the easy part, right? Maybe you would go get a ladder and start cutting down first, but I think most of us would cut from the bottom up. When the temple veil was torn in two, this is why Scripture matters, or one reason why. It specifically says the veil was torn in two from the top to the bottom because God tore it, not man. Nobody walked in there with a pair of scissors and started clipping away. God said, remove that curtain. And he ripped it from the top to the bottom in that order, because God ripped it, because it separated where he dwelt and where men were. And he said, from now on, now that Jesus is resurrected, there's no separation. There's no inner sanctum where only certain people can go once a year. I'm going to dwell among men forever through my Holy Spirit. And now things have changed. Okay? All right, so let's go to the next one. That's Matthew 27. In 70 AD, we know that the Romans destroyed the temple. And so there has not been a temple since 70 AD. So where are we moving with the temple? Well, again, this would be about 45 Sundays if we spent time to talk about each one of these examples. But in the tribulation period, the seven-year tribulation period, there will be a temple. Daniel tells us that the Antichrist will walk into this temple, declare himself God, and defile the temple. So we know there must be a temple during the tribulation period. Now, when do they start rebuilding it? Before the rapture of the church? After the rapture of the church? The Bible doesn't tell us that. We can look at clues in the Bible, and we can get a pretty good idea. But what we do know is there will be a temple that the Antichrist walks into, declares himself God, and this is halfway through the 7 years. This is the midpoint of tribulation. So 3.5 years into tribulation, the Antichrist will walk into the temple. He'll say, I'm God, and will set up statues and stuff of himself in the temple and defile the temple. Daniel calls it the abomination of desolation. So there will be a temple soon in Israel. That's why I'm telling you, when you hear him talking about it on the news, perk your ears. You might want to get on your jumping shoes. That's a rapture reference. Okay. Of the 7 year tribulation period, Revelation says that he'll reign on earth for 1,000 years. We're told in Ezekiel and Revelation, Ezekiel chapter 40, 41, 42, 43, and 44, God explains, or an angel explains to Ezekiel, what the new temple during the millennium reign is going to look like. And we say millennium reign because it's 1,000 years. Christ rules on earth for 1,000 years. And during that 1,000 years, Revelation tells us that it's a special 1,000 years because from the beginning of that 1,000 years to the end of that 1,000 years, Satan has been chained up and tied up in hell. And so he can't tempt the nations for that 1,000 years. And so we basically have earth for 1,000 years with Jesus in the temple, preaching and teaching from it, ruling from the temple, and no devil. Now, I don't know about you, but that sounds like a pretty good 1,000 years. And it's called the millennium reign because the millennium is 1,000 years. And in Ezekiel 40 through 44, those chapters, it tells us what the temple looks like. It spells out exact dimensions. So we know there will be a temple in the future, during tribulation, and when Jesus is back on earth. So let me ask you this. Can you say that you are God's temple? You know, in 1 Corinthians, I think it's chapter 6, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19, says that you yourself are God's holy temple. See, he doesn't want to dwell inside of a room just to be in a room. He wants to dwell where you are, where I am. Y'all want to come back up? They're going to play this last song, and as they do, I want you to ask yourself two things. Number one, can I say that I am God's holy temple, as it says in 1 Corinthians? If the answer to that is no, then invite God to come into your heart. The second thing I would ask you is, if you can say, yes, I'm a born-again Christian, and God dwells in my heart, and I've got His Holy Spirit, let me ask you this. What does the temple look like? Well, I need to lose 10 pounds. That's my New Year's resolution. I'm not talking about what you look like. I'm talking about when God's Holy Spirit is inside of me, what does the room look like that He's in? You follow me? Are there cobwebs and dirty corners? Do I have secret hidden closets in there that nobody else knows about that's got sin locked behind some keypads? Or is it bright and clear in there? You know, there's a great psychological test that says if you close your eyes and imagine yourself in a room and there are no windows, there are no doors, it is just four walls, a ceiling, and a floor, and you're in this square room all by yourself, what does it look like? Now, as you were sitting here, you probably painted a picture of it in your mind. Psychologists say that this tells you what your idea of death is. If you saw this big, bright room, then they say, well, you have a good idea about afterlife, and you believe in an afterlife and that kind of stuff. If they say, well, you're in this dark place and there's no light in there, they're like, ooh, you don't believe in the afterlife, or you've got dark stuff in your life, and you're scared of death and that kind of stuff. But it's a psychological test that they give people that gives them a good handle on what you think about death. Do you fear it? Do you not fear it? Do you think there's life after death? Do you not believe that? That room that you imagined, I want you to imagine the same thing as your heart inside of you when you got saved and the Holy Spirit came into there. Now, obviously, when you first got saved, there was some cleaning to do. You know, nobody walked up to Jesus and said, here I am, I'm perfect. Why don't you come on in right here? Nobody says that. If you do, you're not doing it the right way. You come to Jesus because you say, hey, look, I'm a sinner and I need a Savior, and you're Him. So all this mess that's inside here, I need you to clean it out for me. And He does. He says He washes it as white as the snow. He takes the sin and throws it as far as the east is from the west. And if you get on Google Earth and you start on the east coast and you start going to the west and you keep going west, you'll never stop. You just keep going. There's no part when you start traveling west where you go, oh, I got to turn around because this isn't west anymore. You're always going west. And so God says, I take that sin and I throw it as far as the east is from the west. It didn't come back. It's not a boomerang. Look out, it's coming back. Not one of those deals. He throws it as far as the east is from the west. Buries it on the bottom of the ocean floor is another way to say it. But right now, where the Holy Spirit is in you, is the Holy Spirit in you going, man, I've done a good job in here. It looks good in here. Or are they going, is the Holy Spirit going, well, could use a coat of paint. Some wallpaper wouldn't be a bad idea. There's some nasty stuff in that closet in there, and we need to get it out of there. The Holy Spirit is not going to reach in there and yank it out unless you ask for it. The Holy Spirit is not just going to say, I don't care what you say. I don't care what you're doing. I'm going to fix this for you and reach in there and do it. The Holy Spirit will wait. God will wait. Jesus could have came down and said, you're all saved. You're all going to heaven. See you when you get there. But that's not what He said. He said, he that calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You got to call on Him first. He could have created Adam and Eve to be mindless robots where they had to worship God. No tree of knowledge of good and evil in the garden. No choice to rebel or obey God. He could have done that. But He said, you know what? I'm going to give you one tree that's bad. And you get to choose. You have free will. Will you obey or not obey? And that's what He's saying right now. I've got a temple that I want to dwell in. And you're it. And I want to walk in there and I want to fill it up. I want it to be so bright that other people are like, whoa, what happened to her at church Sunday? Look at her glow. Well, it's my Maybelline. No, you say it's Jesus, right? That's what you want. You want to be those priests walking out of there when you go back to work Monday or whenever you go back, if you're off Monday, Tuesday, and you want people to say, you're different. What's different? I'll tell you what's different. I've been a Christian for a long time, but I got right with Christ. I let Him clean up all the mess in my life this weekend. Or I got saved this weekend, and I invited Jesus Christ into my heart. That's what's different. You want to be that priest walking out of there, people going, whoa, they're shining. Why are they shining? Don't walk out of here today the same way you walked in. Let's clean up some cobwebs. Let's pray. Lord, we thank You so much for the opportunity to gather in Your temple, in Your house, to study Your word, to worship You. Lord, there's people in here right now that they can say, you know what, Lord? I am the temple of Your Holy Spirit. I know You're inside of me. I know that You have saved me. But here lately, Lord, I've been cluttering up that holy temple with some nasty stuff. And so right now, the best way I know how, Lord, I ask You to give me a clean heart and a right spirit and renew me, Lord. And I just rededicate myself to You. And if there's somebody here right now, Lord, that has never asked You to come into their heart, that they would just say right now, Jesus, save me. I'm a sinner. And I need You to come into my heart and make me clean. I need You to make me as white as the snow. And we ask these things in Your name, Lord Jesus. Amen.